Let's turn to page 350. 'Tis so sweet to trust in Jesus as we stand first and last. You're here. We welcome our visitors. May the Lord bless and minister to your heart. Thank you for coming. Others are continuing to come in. We're going to begin with prayer and ask the Lord to help us today. We have one of our ladies at the hospital with urgent care, Miss Ashley Griffith, and so that's Nathan's back here behind me somewhere. But their son's really sick. They're not sure what's going on. Might be a blockage. We just don't even know. But so she's at the urgent care with little Bowman. So we'll remember him. And then Krista Spencer is also at the hospital with her dad. And don't quote me, of course, but very good possibility there might have been a stroke yesterday or day before. But not sure what's going on. MRIs, more testing for Krista's dad. So she's up there with him, all right? Let's pray for these and ask God to bless the service.
Let's pray. Dear Lord, we sure do love you this morning. Thank you for the opportunity and a privilege to be in your house. And I pray for little Bowman this morning. I pray, God, that you'll touch that young boy. God, bless him, Lord. Let the doctors help him. And I pray for Mr. Fisher. I pray for Krista and pray for that family, Lord, as they deal with this cancer. And I pray and ask you, Lord, to give them the grace they need today. And Lord, you know every need in this building and every need in every family in this building. And Lord, this morning on this Lord's Day, we've come to worship the Lord Jesus Christ. We've come to lift up the name of Jesus. And I pray and ask you, Father, that you'll touch our hearts and deal with us today. Lord, help us to repent of our sins and turn away from this world and just gets more wicked by the day. And I pray and ask you, Lord, that you'll just bless this service. Lord, if there's a lost soul in the building, I pray, God, this will be the day that you'll prick their heart and they'll repent of their sins and seek the Savior. I pray and ask you, Lord, in Jesus' name, touch our man of God. Bless our preacher. Lord, anoint him. Fill him with the Holy Ghost. Help him to preach. And Father, I pray that you'll prepare every heart this morning for a habitation of God. Prepare our hearts to gladly receive what you have for us. Lord, there's no other reason for us to be here than that we're like-minded and we're saved by the grace of God. Bless every song that's sung. Bless, dear God, the musicians. Bless the special singing. Lord, bless the preaching of your word. We love you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Be seated all over the building. Again, welcome our visitors. We have visitors everywhere throughout the congregation. It looks like in about all three sections of the church. We're glad you're here. May the Lord bless you. Please come back, all right? Service tonight at 6 p.m. and then service Wednesday night at 7 p.m. And we'd love to have you in any of those services if you can make it, okay? We're asking for everybody's help for the Easter in the Park. First of all, we want everybody to grab brochures and use those cards and start giving them out to your community, your neighborhood, your family, your friends, co-workers. We need to get these cards out. All the way to March 30th, all right? So let's do that. Get you a handful today. Then also, some are bringing candy already. And we ask you to continue to bring bags of candy. Put them in the security room. We appreciate that so much as well, all right? Let's have the ushers come on in. We'll get the regular tithe and the regular offering. Encourage you to give as unto the Lord. And thank you for all several of you up in the balcony. May God bless you for being up in the balcony today. I think we have visitors' cards on about all you visitors, and so I appreciate that, and thank you for filling those out. Just make yourself a home here at Mountain View Baptist Church, all right? God bless you while the choir sings, you worship and you're giving.
Our number 50, Sweet Forever, amen.
Future is ours, amen. That hope is ours. Thank God for the hope. Thank God for the future of heaven. And you know what? We could ship out today. We really could. Could ship out today. Brother, let's see. Oh my goodness. I'll get it right. Brother Trey, come pray for us, all right? My mind done went blank. Pray for us and dedicate the altar.
Lord, thank you again for letting us be here this morning. Thank you for the good Sunday school hour, what we learned, what we heard. God, thank you for your word that forever teaches and forever speaks to our hearts. And Lord, we thank you that we've been encouraged already. Lord, thank you for, again, the privilege to be physically able when so many can't. We beg you, God, if you would, to really touch, really comfort, really pull alongside of these, Lord, that are struggling this morning. I sure pray in Jesus' name, would you do a great healing work and a comfort work, and Lord, that you just minister to hearts, I pray. Thank you for the privilege to give this morning. Thank you for the privilege to work a job and be able to give back to you. I sure pray, would you smile on the offering? I pray, God, most of all, that you'd smile on the service this morning, the entire day, tonight. Please, God, bless the pastor, Lord, and help him as he preaches. Please use Brother Cooper this morning in Ohio. And God, I just ask that you'd help us today, Lord, that Jesus would be high and lifted up. And Lord, that your power and your presence, Lord, be our portion this morning. And we'll thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Bless His soul. never thirst again. Now through the Spirit of the Son to the Father I can say, for your saving blood and for all you've done, well, bless your holy name.
Let's do the first and last, My Savior's Love, as the adult choir comes down and the youth choir will come up. Youth choir.
Everybody, welcome our visitors. All right, we have a trio. I think they have a new song, and that's always a blessing to have a new song. And so I hope we'll identify with it. And then we're going to have the youth choir, all right? You worship during the special music, all right?
Just before we sing, I just want to thank the Lord for saving me this morning. Yeah. Thankful for grace. Thankful for forgiveness, for mercy. I've been a recipient of all those things, and I sure am thankful this morning for that. I love our Bible. I love the stories in the Bible and what we can learn and what we can glean from it. Right. I've always loved the story of the prodigal son, and we're going to sing a song about that this morning. I love that story because I of all the stories, I love to picture that and visualize that, and I can see that that young man, when he came to himself, when he realized he needed to go back home, and started on that long path. No doubt the despondency and the shame and the embarrassment hanging over him like a heavy cloud, and not sure what he'd find when he got home. And I don't know, you know, how long that road was, but at some point he looked up and he saw something that he probably had never seen before. Our Bible, your King James Bible says, when the Father, when he was yet a great way off, I don't know how far that is, but it sounds pretty far, but the Father saw him, and that sounds to me like he was already looking for him. And he had compassion. My, I've been a recipient of that compassion. And then those next two words said, and ran. Didn't walk. He didn't stand there waiting with his arms crossed, with glaring in judgment or condemnation, but he ran to him. He fell on his neck and kissed him. And I'm so thankful. That means a lot to me this morning because it tells me no matter how far out you get, no matter the stench of the hog pen that may be hanging on you and the scars of sin, no matter what you do, you can always go back home. And when you do, it's the only time in your Bible God ran to him. And he'll run to you, and he ran to me one day. I sure am thankful for that this morning. Bless his name.
God, the great I am, immovable rock, omnipotent, powerful, awesome Lord, victorious warrior, commanding King of kings, mighty conqueror, and the only time, the only time I ever saw him run was when he ran to me. He took me in his arms, held my head to his chest, said, my son's come home again, lifted my face, wiped the tears from my eyes with forgiveness in his voice. He said, son, do you know I still love you? He caught me by surprise. God ran. The day I left home, I knew I'd broken his heart. I wondered then if things would ever be the same. Then one night I remembered his love for me. Down a dusty road ahead I could see. It was the only time. It was the only time I ever saw him run. Was when he ran to me. He took me in his arms, held my head to his chest, said, my son's come home again, lifted my face, wiped the tears from my eyes with forgiveness in his voice. He said, son, do you know I still love you? He caught me by surprise, and he brought me to my knees. I was so ashamed.
tears from my eyes. With forgiveness in his voice, I felt his love for me again. He ran to me. He took me in his arms, held my head to his chest, said, my son's come home again. Lifted my face, wiped the tears from my eyes. With forgiveness in his voice, he said, son, my God called me son. He ran to me. He ran to me. He ran to me. He ran to me. When God ran.
What a great, great song. Amen. How true. How absolutely true. All right. They're going to get everything ready for the youth choir. And I'd like to say good to see Miss Suzanne, her family. God bless you and the loss, recent loss of your brother. May God bless you and your family. And I know the folks in the church have been praying for you. And then we also have another brother that's not here, two brothers that are not here. That's Brother Larry Newsom and Aaron. They're on the way down, I think, to the coast. I think that's what they told me. And his daughter, Nicole, was having some issues, some heart irregular beats and all that kind of stuff. So they've gone to get her and bring her back. So remember Brother Newsom and Nicole, Aaron, all them as they travel today, all right, and get back home. Are y'all ready? Come on, God bless you.
The pen of the writer could write every day. Not
think everybody in the building could absolutely say an amen to that song. We have been blessed. Take your Bibles, everybody. Go with me to Exodus 25 and Exodus 27. We'll start in Exodus 25, page 100, in an old Schofield Bible, if that's what you're carrying. Page 100, Exodus chapter number 25. I cover your prayers. We endeavor to preach this morning and give God's people and those that are unsaved what we feel like we need to bring today, all right? Exodus 25, please look, if you will, in verse number 1. And the Lord spake unto Moses, saying, speak unto the children of Israel that they bring me an offering of every man that giveth it willingly with his heart, ye shall take my offering. Verse number 8, and let them make me a sanctuary that I may dwell among them. The entire purpose of bringing the offering collectively for the nation of Israel was to construct a sanctuary, a tabernacle, all right? Now go to Exodus 27, please, if you will. Give me all you can. Thank you, Brother Philip. Exodus 27, look in verse number 1. Here is one of the descriptive sections of one of the pieces of furniture in the tabernacle. Of course, not all of them, but one. Verse number 1, let me stop a minute. Brother Nathan, I noticed you stepped out. Did you get any recent updates? You okay? Okay, all right, pray for the little guy. Exodus 27, verse 1, and thou shalt make an altar of shittim wood, 5 cubits long and 5 cubits broad. The altar shall be 4 square, and the height thereof shall be 3 cubits. And most people recognize a cubit to be approximately, Brother Randy, 18 inches. So about 18 inches there. Verse number 2, thou shalt make the horns of it upon the 4 corners thereof. His horns shall be of the same. Thou shalt overlay it with brass. Thou shalt make his pans to receive his ashes, and his shovels, and his basins, and his flesh hooks, and his fire pans, all the vessels thereof, thou shalt make of brass. Thou shalt make for it a grate, and this is really like a grill work, of network of brass. And upon the net, the grill work, shalt thou make 4 brazen rings in the 4 corners thereof. Thou shalt put it under the compass of the altar beneath, that's the upper ledge, that the net, or the grate there, may be even to the midst of the altar, right in the middle, in other words. Thou shalt make staves, wooden poles, for the altar, staves of shittim wood, and overlay them with brass. And the staves shall be put into the rings, and the staves shall be upon the 2 sides of the altar to bear it, to carry it, in other words. They weren't allowed to touch these holy vessels. They had to bear them with staves. Verse number 8, hollow with boards shalt thou make it, as it was showed thee in the mount, so shall they make it. All right, that's reading chapter 27, verses 1 through 8. And this morning, with the Lord being our helper, I want to preach upon the subject of blessings from the brazen altar. Blessings from the brazen altar. As we examine the book of Exodus, we find that God has instructed Moses to construct a portable, collapsible, tent-like sanctuary, so that the Israelite nation could have a place to sacrifice and a place to worship God Jehovah. We know that to be called the tabernacle in the wilderness. And within this tabernacle, or this tent of meeting, were 7 specific pieces of furniture that were situated inside of the 3 courts of the tabernacle. And as we come in the door, which was a hanging curtain, as we come in the door, we move into the outer court, all the way to the inner court, and we find, Brother David, these 7 great instruments are 7 pieces of furniture. And the first one is what I read in your hearing today. It's called the brazen, or the brass, or even the copper altar, all right? And there we find that it typifies or represents Jesus Christ as our Passover sacrifice for us. We leave the brazen altar. By the way, that was the first stop, all right? That was the first piece of furniture that anybody ever encountered, Brother Landon. It was the brazen altar. And I want to hurry up and say that the way of the cross leads home. Amen. And I want to hurry up and say that he said, I am the way, I am the truth, and I am the life. No man comes to the Father but by me. If you don't get to Calvary, you're never going to go. I said, if you don't go by Calvary, you're never going to go to heaven. And you're never going to go any further in the Christian life. It all starts at the brazen altar. It all begins with our sacrifice. It all begins with the Lord Jesus Christ laying down his life as our sweet-smelling savior unto God. I'm glad March the 30th of 1976, by the eye of faith, thank God, Brother Trey, I stopped at the brazen altar. I accepted the sacrifice. I accepted the shed blood. I accepted what happened on that altar. And that altar typifies the cross of Jesus Christ upon which the Prince of Glory died. I've got good news for you, friend. That somebody loved you so much that he died for you. That somebody didn't want you to go to hell, and so he died for you. And somebody wanted you to go to heaven, and so he laid down his life unwillingly. Thank God, on an old rugged cross. I say to you, hey friend, it starts at the brazen altar. Amen. And the brazen altar has always, and I read it to you, represented Jesus Christ as our Passover and our sacrifice. You leave the brazen altar and you go forward. We're going from the out of the tabernacle all to the holy, all the way to the Holy of Holies. You stop with the brazen laver, and that had water in it, Brother Brian, and that the brazen or brass laver, that's where the priest and Aaron and his sons would wash their hands and cleanse themselves. You know what, friend? Not only is Christ our sacrifice, but thank God he's our sanctification. I said he is our sanctification. You leave the brazen laver and you go to the holy place and you stop at the golden lampstand. You could stop at the light, and Christ is not only our sacrifice, and Christ is not only our sanctification, but I want to say to you today that Christ is the light of the world. Amen. He's the light of the world. Brother Wofford, we leave the golden candlestick and we turn to the right and we find the table of showbread. Brother Josh had always had a showbread for the priest as an offering. But you know what that represents? That represents only one thing. Jesus Christ is not only our sacrifice, and Jesus Christ is not only our sanctification, and Jesus Christ is not only the light of the world, but I want to hurry up and say he is the bread of life. I said he is the bread of life. And can I tell you something? He satisfies. Amen. He satisfies. I'm trying to hurry. I really am trying to hurry. But I know there's unsaved people in this sanctuary today. And so I am compelled, I am constrained how to throw out the lifeline and to care for the dying. Hey, friend, you're not here by accident. You're not here by chance. I know you started your car. I know you drove down here. I know you got your clothes on. But I want to tell you, it's God that gave you the strength. It's God that put that desire in you. It's God that doesn't work by accident. But God brought you here today to hear the truth of the Word of God. And I want to tell you, Jesus Christ is the table of showbread. He is the bread of life that satisfies the hungry soul. Thank God there's no thirsting for life's pleasures adorning rich and gay. Why, friend? Because, hallelujah, I've been satisfied. Amen. We're talking about the furniture of the tabernacle. You start at the brazen altar. You go to the brazen laver. You go into the holy place. You find the golden lampstand. You find, Josh, the table of showbread. But watch this right here. Man, I got to hurry up. You find next the golden altar. The golden altar. Brother Wofford, the golden altar is the altar of incense, where Miss Cooper, they light incense as a savor unto God, as the word of Nathan, an offering unto God. You know what that golden laver, that golden altar represents? Oh, it's good, friend. Christ is our high priest. Amen. He is our high priest. That's always interceding for you and I. You know what? Let me just put a commercial in right here. Without Jesus Christ, your life is a zero. Amen. I said, without Christ, you're of all men most miserable. Without salvation, you're on a toboggan slide to hell. I said, without salvation, you are on a toboggan slide to hell. Don't you know that the greatest thing that could ever happen to you is for you to give your heart and your life unto Jesus Christ, to accept Him, to let Him come into your life, let Him save you, let Him change you, let Him give you peace, amen, let Him give you joy, let Him give you satisfaction. I say to you, and all of us have said the same thing, He's the best thing that's ever happened to us. I said, He's the best thing that's ever happened to us. I can't imagine my life. I cannot imagine my life without salvation. Amen. My God, God's been good. God's been good. Of the millions and billions on planet Earth, I'm one of the saved individuals. I'm going to heaven when I die. I'm going to heaven when I die. Not because of who I am. Not because of my last name. Not because of where I go to church. Not because I got baptized. I'm going to heaven, Brother Josh, because one day I asked this Jesus Christ to come into my life. And that Jesus Christ, He came into my life and He changed me forever. Jesus Christ is the brazen altar. He's the sacrifice. Could I get some help up here? Jesus Christ is the brazen laver where we find cleansing. He is, Brother Brian, our daily sanctification. Washed with the water of the Word. I love that golden lampstand. Brother Randy, that was always burning. Oh man, I just got too much to preach. You know why it was always burning? Of a never-ending supply of oil. Hallelujah goes right there. And the oil, Brother Gordon, is the Holy Spirit, the Holy Ghost of God. I want to say to you that Jesus is the light of the world. Oh, you move over to the table of showbread. Jesus Christ, He is the bread of life. I know what you're thinking. You're thinking, well, why do you make so much of the Lord Jesus? Well, we make so much of the Lord Jesus because He said in Acts chapter 4 and verse number 12, neither is there salvation in any other, for there is none other name under heaven given among men whereby you must be saved. It's the cross or it's hell. It's the blood or it's hell. It's Jesus or it's hell. It's God's salvation or it's hell. And it's misery. Can you imagine, Brother Randy, being unhappy in this world and then being unhappy for all of eternity? You know why you're going to be unhappy for all of eternity? Because you said no to the grace of God. Let me get a little bit more plainer, okay? Y'all pray for the preacher this morning, okay? I'll have the right vein to follow, and I think I'm in the right vein. Let me make it a little bit more plain for you. He knocked on your door. He knocked on your heart. He tugged at your heartstrings. He brought you under conviction. No man can come to the Father, which the Father sent me. Draw him. Draw him. He drew you with cords of love. He drew you with the grace of God. The grace of God hath appeared to all men. Friend, He's talked to you and He dealt with you. But you know what you've done? You know what you've done? You've closed the book. You've said, no, I don't need Him. I don't want Him. I'm not ready for that. I'm not sure I can live it. Look up here, friend. We can't live it either. We can't live it either. But thank God I've got somebody, Brother Derek, on the inside that helps me live it every day. I'm so glad I'm saved. It's pitiful, amen. I'm so glad I'm saved. I tell you, it's the greatest thing in the world. It's the best thing in the world. And I want to say to you, it's what you need, friend. It's what you need in your life. If you've ever recognized that you're a sinner, if you've ever recognized that you need prayer, if you've ever recognized that the Holy Ghost knocked on the door of your heart, you're in a good place. I said, you're in a good place. And I got news for you. You can get saved today. Today you can get saved. The Bible said, Brother Randy, now is the accepted time. Today is the day of salvation. You know what else it says, dear neighbor? Dear neighbor, I love you, and that's why I'm preaching like I am. You know what else it says? Boast not thyself of tomorrow, for thou knowest not what a day may bring forth. The time to do business with God is when God is dealing with you. Amen, everybody? Josh, I sat about right back there, a little bit farther back than Malachi. Douglas is sitting now. I got that right, didn't I, Malachi? I finally got it right. Give me an A, all right? My next report card, give me an A. I was sitting about that far back. Brother Doug Pine, they preached twice. They sung all night. Brother Kyle, the head said, heavy head bowed, every eye closed. Brother Perry, I'm almost certain they started singing "Just As I Am" without one plea. But that thy blood was shed for me. Oh, Lamb of God, I come. I come. I can't explain it to you. I'll never figure it all out. There were probably 400 plus people in that building. I was sitting right about where Malachi was, and out of nowhere, Brother Kyle, out of nowhere, I didn't hear an audible voice. I didn't have a dream. I didn't see a vision. I wasn't hallucinating. It wasn't a figment of my imagination. It wasn't a fairy tale. It wasn't Aesop's fables. I'm telling you what happened to me. I had something on the inside. Something on the inside. Oh, man, I mean, it's like somebody was in there. Amen. It's like somebody was in there. And man, he got my heart running fast. I mean, he got my heart. I got all nervous, Samuel. I said, God, have mercy. They're singing "Just As I Am" without one plea. But that thy blood was shed for me. And I've never been saved. I've never trusted Christ. I'm going to go to hell. A straight A student. I minded my mama. Honored my mom. I did what mama told me to do. But I was going to go to hell as a straight A student. But I tell you what, Brother David, I looked up that day, that night. I said, nope, it ain't worth going to hell for nobody. It don't matter what they think, what he thinks, what she thinks, what somebody else thinks. I'm not going to hell for nobody. I tell you, that night, I left that pew, Brother Malachi. I walked down that altar, and the whole time I was singing, "Just as I am, without one plea, but that thy blood was shed for me. Oh, Lamb of God, oh, Lamb of God, I come. Oh, Lamb of God, I come." I fell on that altar, and for the first time in my life, I called upon the name of the Lord. Romans chapter 10, verse number 13 says, "For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved." Young man, are you listening? Young lady, are you listening? I called on his name. And guess what happened? Guess what happened? Thank God he saved me. He came into my heart. He gave me eternal life. Mark, he gave me peace that passes all understanding. He changed my destiny. He changed my heart. Why are you shutting the book? Why are you saying no? Why are you slamming the door? Why are you refusing to get saved? What do you think you're here for today? It's not an accident. It's not perchance. It's not an afterthought. You are here because God wanted you here. You could have been in jail. You could have been in hell. You could have been at the nursing home. You could have been at the hospital. But God gave you health. God gave you a car. God gave you a mind. God gave you clothes to put on. God gave you a little bit of breakfast before you got here. And God brought you to church. You know why? Because he wanted you to hear somebody tell you one more time that you can be saved before it's too late. Why do you wait? Why do you tarry? Why are you procrastinating? I said, why are you procrastinating? Why would you put off today what you can do? Why would you put off tomorrow what you can do today? You know, we love you. We care about you. And I'll tell you this, and I'm just going to be really transparent with you. We've been praying for some of you. We really have. You've been praying, by name. By name. We want you to go to heaven. We want your sins to be forgiven. We don't want you, and I'm not cussing here, but we don't want you to bust hell wide open. We don't want you to bust hell wide open. And that's where you're going to go if you've never been saved. That's where you're going to go if Jesus doesn't live in your heart. That's where you're going to go if you've never called on him. You've never repented of your sin. Oh, friend, listen. Listen, he's the best thing. And he'll be the greatest thing that's ever happened to your life. You know how wonderful it is to lay down at night? And you may have problems. And you may have worries. And you may be at the hospital. But you know how wonderful it is to lay down your head at night thinking, well, everything else may be going wrong, but one thing's for sure, I'm still going to heaven when I die. My God, I'm still going to heaven when I die. Oh, friend, are you listening? Are you listening? Oh, happy day that fixed my choice on thee, my Savior and my God. Well, may this glowing heart rejoice and tell its raptures all abroad. Happy day. Happy day when Jesus washed my sins away. Help me, God. Help me. Somebody help me. Help me, Derek. Come on, Derek. Where's my son at now? He what? He taught me how to watch and pray and live rejoicing every day. Happy day. Happy day when Jesus washed my sins away. You can sing that. You can sing that. You can say that. That can be your testimony. When you come into the tabernacle, Brother Josiah, when you walk into the tabernacle, the tent of meeting, the tabernacle in the wilderness, when you walk in, Miss Barbara, you see the brazen altar, the very first piece of furniture. The brazen altar represents Christ as our Passover, a sacrifice for us. You move forward, you come to the brazen laver. That's where you have cleansing and water. Christ, Brother Galloway, is our sanctification. You go into the holy place, the second court, as it were. You go into the holy place, you find the golden candlestick, the golden menorah, whatever you want to use the Jewish word, the golden lampstand. Brother Trey, Christ is the light of the world. You move over to the right or the left, you find showbread laid out. Christ is the bread of life. You go forward, you come now, Brother Andy, to the golden altar. It's the altar of incense. Incense is a type of prayer. Incense going up to God as a sweet-smelling savor. And Christ is our high priest. You know what that means? That means once you get saved, once you become a child of God, this is shouting ground right here. Once you become a child of God, Brother Perry, you have somebody interceding for you for the rest of your life. And you know what? You know what tickles me? You know what? Whatever. You know what blesses me? He can pray for me. He can pray for you and you and you and you all at the same time and never miss me. Hey, friend, I'm engraving on his hand. I'm engraving on his hand. Hey, friend, I'm one of those stones on his chest. I'm one of those shoulder stones. He'd bury me on his shoulder and he'd bury me on his chest and he'd bury me on his hand. Hey, friend, he knows my God. He knows me by name. I said he knows me by name. He is my great high priest. I say to you today, Jesus Christ is my great high priest. Look up here. Don't get mad. Don't get mad. Forget Roman Catholicism. Forget Roman Catholicism. It's heresy and it's a cult. Say amen. We're not going that route. I don't need that. I don't want that. I preach against that. I have a high priest that's seated at the right hand of the throne of God. And guess what? Not only, Brother Josh, can I send incense up and I can send prayers up, but Brother Madeline, he's praying for me. Yes. Amen. Let me get one verse. Help me, Lord. Help me, Jesus. Yeah, let me get it. There it is. Hebrews 7:25. Wherefore, he is able to save them to the uttermost. That means completely. That come unto God by him. Why? Brother Brian, seeing he ever liveth to make intercession for them. Christ is our great high priest. One more. You got a minute, don't you? You got a minute? I hope you got a minute. God's helping us today. He really is helping us. Romans 8, who is he that condemneth? It is Christ that died, yea, rather that is risen again. Who is he even at the right hand of God who also maketh intercession for us? I say to you today, if you ever become a Christian, if you ever give your life to Christ, we're fixing to give an invitation. And I want us to sing just as I am, if that's all right. We're fixing to give an invitation. And I want to tell you, if you ever get saved, if you ever turn your life to Christ, if you ever confess your sins and turn from your sin and accept the free gift of salvation for the rest of your men, this is good stuff. Walmart ain't got nothing like this. Sears ain't got nothing like this. Amen. 401k don't have nothing like this. For the rest of your life, the rest of your life, you'll have a great high priest that's interceding for you and representing you before the Father. We come, Josh, to the golden altar, the altar of incense. Christ is our high priest. There are two more pieces of furniture, and I'll be finished for right now. The two more pieces of furniture. You leave the holy place. Brother Andy, you go beyond the veil. I could preach all day about the veil. You go into what we call, y'all help me right here. Help me, are you ready? The holy of holies. Place where God manifests himself. God's not going to manifest himself except at one place, the Ark of the Covenant. But wait a minute, Nathan. The Ark of the Covenant has to make sure that it has the mercy seat on it with the cherubim and their wings looking down. Well, what are the cherubims looking down at? Oh, friend, where you been all your life? The sprinkled blood, the propitiation for our sin, and not for our sins only, but for the sins of the whole world. Friend, I tell you, and then God would meet with the high priest. Here's what I want to tell you. In that Holy of Holies, all those other five pieces of furniture, Miss Jenny, they weren't in that Holy of Holies. But I tell you what was in that Holy of Holies, the Ark of the Covenant and the mercy seat. And that's where God said, watch this, I've got to hurry. That's where God said, Miss Crystal, I will meet with you. I will meet with you. As you see the Ark of the Covenant, Christ is our communion. Christ is our fellowship. Oh, my. Don't you love it? Don't you love it when he can commune and fellowship with you? Have you ever been in your car? Help me now. I want some help right here. Have you ever been in your car, your truck? Nobody in the car or the truck with you. You might have been listening to some preaching. You might have been listening to some good singing. You might have just been praying to yourself. And I'll tell you, God gave you a visit from the third heaven. Right in the car. And you're going down the car and tears are coming down your eyes. Or if you're like me, you're beating that middle console. You're just slapping that middle console. Or you're saying, hallelujah, hallelujah. Come to the stop sign, raise your hand. You're not waving to Fred and Joe and Sally. They're looking at you like there's something wrong with him. No, nothing wrong with him. He just had a meeting from the third heaven. God is real. God is real. He said, at that Ark of the Covenant, I'll meet with you. I'll fellowship with you. I'll commune with you. But watch it. I'm looking for something. Come on, Tiffany. Come on, Jada. I'm looking for something. I'm looking for something on that Ark of the Covenant. There's got to be something else on that Ark of the Covenant. Yeah, there was, Brother Andy. It's called the mercy seat. Y'all didn't get that, did you? Mercy seat. Mercy seat. Mercy seat. He didn't give me justice. He didn't give me justice. I said he didn't give me justice. Thank God he gave me mercy. I didn't deserve it. I'm fixing to run. I'm fixing to run. He didn't give me what I deserved. I didn't get what I deserved. I got what I didn't deserve. I got what I didn't deserve. That's mercy. Mercy. God, Jesse and wife, I should know your name. I'll get it before it's over with. God said, I'm going to give you mercy based on what I see sprinkled on that mercy seat. But what was on that mercy seat? It wasn't a prayer cloth. It wasn't any tithe. It wasn't no tithes and offerings. The priest came in with that blood of the slain sacrifice from the brazen altar. Joey, Donna, he applied the blood. You know what God said? There it is. And when I see the blood, I will pass over you. For all my sin, for all my wrong, for all my unbelief, Bonnie Robbins, I didn't get justice. Mr. Glassman, I got mercy. I got mercy. But I only got mercy because of the blood. And by the way, Christ is not only our communion. Here's a big word. Christ is our propitiation. Our propitiation. That blood satisfied the Father. And the Father says, I can pardon now. My God, I'm having a good time and I'm the one doing the preaching. I can pardon now. I can forgive. I can, great day of atonement, Leviticus 16. I can cover sin. Oh, my God. I shouldn't have said that. I said it anyway. I can cover sins for a year. I can cover sins for another year. But guess what? John 1? Absolutely. That's my coat. I'm pulling my coat. That's that John 1. Behold, the Lamb of God. He doesn't cover them for a year. He takes away. He takes away. He takes away the sin of the whole world. Give me a coat. Give me a coat. Give me a coat. Hurry up. Hurry up. Give me a coat. Give me a coat. Give me a coat. Come up here, man. Come on, help me preach. Jump the rail, son. Jump the rail. Jump the rail. Jump the rail. All right, kind of bend down. Kind of bend down. There you go. Kind of bend down. From all the Old Testament, all God did in Leviticus 16 was cover the sin for a whole year. Then they have to go give more sacrifice next year to cover the sin for a whole year. Friend, listen. Stand up. He didn't cover it. He didn't cover it. Took it away. Lift both hands and thank you. Lift both hands and thank you. I'm pulling the Sammy Allen on him now. I could tell him to run around the building sick, but I'm not. Don't worry, don't worry. Aren't you glad you're saved? You've been forgiven? You've been washed? You've been cleansed? Going to heaven when you die? How old were you?
I was 12 years old.
12 years old. Ask God to save him. What in the world are you waiting on? Why don't you ask God to save you today? Why don't you ask God to save you today? You know what that was, Josh? That was just the introduction. Because I'm fixing to preach tonight on the brazen altar. But all seven pieces of furniture represent something. And they have special significance and meaning for our life. Are you saved, ma'am? Are you saved, sir? I'm not asking you to join our church. I'm not asking you to get baptized. I'm not asking for any of your money. I'm not asking for that. I'm asking you, are you saved? And if you're not saved, why don't you get saved today? Get saved today. Heads are bowed, eyes are closed. Christians are really praying. Christians are praying. Christians are praying all over this building. Christians are praying. Folks, don't get distracted. Don't get distracted. Christians are praying. How many in this building say, you know what? I'm not saved. I'm just not. And I know that I'm not. I know that I'm not saved. And I don't want to go to hell. And I want to ask you to please, and I'm not going to call your name, and I'm not going to leave this pulpit and come back to you. I'm not coming back to you. But I want to know, sir, lady, boy, girl, grandmother, grandfather, do you care enough to say, I'm going to lift my hand because I want you to pray for me? I don't want to die in the shape I am. I'm in, and die and go to hell. Would you lift your hand? Let me pray for you. Would you lift your hand real high? Lift it real high. Just a moment. Just a moment. Lift your high hand. Lift your hand. Let me pray for you. Let me ask God to save you before it's too late in the balcony. There's a little one in the balcony. Thank you, sweetheart. Somebody else? Somebody else? Preacher, pray for me. God bless you, young lady. Thank you, sweetheart. Thank you. Thank you, little one. How about it, sir? How about it, sir? God bless you, little guy. Thank you so much, little man. Somebody else? Somebody else today? I'm not saved. I'm not saved. Please pray for me. Lift your hand right now. Right now. Please pray for me. Heavenly Father, you saw the youngsters, the little ones that are lost. And I pray, first of all, you'll give all of us wisdom, especially moms and dads, to know how to prayerfully and skillfully deal with their children. And they come to a saving knowledge of Jesus before it's too late. Thank you for the tabernacle, Lord. Thank you for these great seven pieces of furniture. Thank you for the Holy of Holies and the Ark of the Covenant and the mercy seat where the blood was applied. Lord, save the lost. I know there's people here that are unsaved. I beg you, Father, in Jesus' name, that you would deepen conviction and do a work in their heart. And we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's sing this song.
Page 342.
Sing it, everybody. I like that song. Come on, don't drag the song. Don't drag it. Don't drag it. Don't kill the song. Don't kill the song.